morning, I'm John Riley. I'm visiting here at the Forbes Library on behalf of the Mass Center for the Book and for Northampton Community Television. We have an initiative to visit most of the local libraries here in the Valley to see their special collections and things that they have that set them apart from so many other libraries. New England is blessed with public libraries in every town, every village, and each one has something special. Today, we're at the Forbes Library, and we're meeting with Elise.
Elise Bernier-Feely.
She's in charge of local history and genealogy. Mm-hmm. She's quite famous here in town. Everybody that's grown up here has probably visited Elise at one time or another to find out about their families. Elise, how long have you been in charge of local history and genealogy?
Well, I retired from the reference department, where I was head of reference from 1982 to 2006. After my retirement, my passion is local history and genealogy. So I stayed on 3 days a week to do local history and to help people do genealogical searches of their families.
Had you worked at the library in any other capacity before you did reference?
Actually, I worked at Springfield City Library.
Oh, nice. Yeah.
I worked at the main branch and also some of the other branches, especially Pine Point Branch on Boston Road.
How did you come to Northampton and to Forbes?
Well, Mr. Greenberg, who was kind of an icon, you know, in the Valley as far as a librarian is concerned, he was a wonderful reference librarian, and he was also a great help to people who wanted to look at Northampton history or Valley history. So when he retired, there were many, many people who wanted to come to Forbes to do reference, genealogy, and local history. I think I was chosen because I had all three complements. Mm-hmm. I had worked in genealogy and local history before, and that was a special interest of mine besides reference. So I was blessed to come to Forbes Library.
Where did you grow up?
I grew up in the Connecticut Valley.
Yes.
And I spent a lot of my childhood in East Hampton and for a brief time in Chicopee and some in Northampton.
So you really know the whole Valley. So.
I love the Valley. And yeah. Since I was 16 years old or thereabouts, I've been studying the history of the Valley.
It's really interesting to me because I mentioned to you when we met before, I'm not a local, so everything is new to me. I've lived here almost 40 years, mm-hmm. but I'm still discovering things. In fact, I only recently discovered this collection because I'm not being a local, I'm not here researching my family history.
Right.
But when you took over, is this pretty much what it looked like? Was this, well, no, you've renovated the library, that's right.
Right, we went through a major renovation, three stages of mm-hmm. it. The reference room, and we had already done the children's room. We put in an elevator, access elevator.
It's just beautiful the way it's turned out. Yeah,
wonderful. And of course, this floor, the arts and music floor, and the gallery, and the Calvin Coolidge Presidential Library yeah. Museum, they're all show places.
They really are. They're a real treasure for the city.
But this room was my dream.
Did you have a hand in designing it?
Just a tad. Mm-hmm. But I was involved in other things in the renovation, mostly the front floor, the first floor. All of this material was in many places in the library. Mm. I used to have to actually, a lot of the time, I had to climb ladders. There was a one collection, the World War II collection and the World War I collection, where I had to walk the plank to get there. We had a plank over a staircase, and I had to unlock doors. And
sounds like vertigo.
It was a challenge. Mm. But maybe there were 11 or 12 places in the library that had local history materials and genealogy materials. Chiefly, those materials were along the wall of the west wall, actually, of, no, it's the east wall, sorry, east wall mm-hmm. of the arts and music department in locked cases. And so I was very much going up and down staircases to get materials for people so that they could use them.
You know, the Forbes is very famous for having really fabulous books that go back to the founding. I was reading some history about the library and how Cutter had gone to Europe with $50,000 and came back with 3,000 fabulous books. And yes, he was a real innovator and a real spark for this library being as mm-hmm. unique as it is.
Yes, Cutter really set the tone for mm-hmm. Forbes Library yeah. in the beginning. He came from the Boston Athenaeum by way of Harvard College. That's where he went to school. And then he worked for a time at the Boston Public Library. Yeah. His aunts wanted him to be a Unitarian minister. Mm-hmm. He threw that over for librarianship because he fell in love with libraries, and in particular, one cataloger who became his mentor. And he began to see the need to catalog books. You know, in the old days, you had almost account books where you would put the first book that came into the library and then chronologically every other book.
Yes.
But there was no way for anyone to see, to anyone to browse in a section or to see what you had. So Cutter became a really innovative cataloger and developed something called the expansive classification system. Anything that the mind of man or woman could see in the future can be cataloged through the expansive classification system.
And Northampton is fairly unique. I guess there are a couple of other libraries that still use the Cutter classification system.
Yes, and it's the basis, really, if you look at it, for the Library of Congress system. Mm-hmm. They borrowed quite liberally from Cutter in order to do their system.
Did he invent or develop the catalog card system of cataloging?
He helped with that. Yes, he yeah. helped with that.
Because before then, yeah. you had a big book that listed all the books.
That's right. Yeah. He was a systematizer. Mm-hmm. What I mean by that is he could look at a series of books and tell the front desk, this one will go out for 2 weeks, this one will go out for four, based on the size and the width of the book.
Yeah. How long would it take somebody to read it?
Oh, he was
he was
amazing.
Always thinking, yeah.
He was also an innovator in the sense that he was interested in women in libraries. He was one of the first to ask women to do reference work in libraries, which was unheard of. So we look upon him as a feminist as well.
Well, we're always counting on mm-hmm. women's great memories to remember everything. Well, for all that Cutter did, he couldn't have done it without Forbes. Mm-hmm. What was Mr. Forbes' first name?
Charles Edward Forbes.
Okay.
He actually changed his name. It was Forbes. F-O-B-E-S, which is a Scotch-Irish name.
Okay.
He changed it because I think he had difficulties. People had difficulties pronouncing it correctly anyway. Mm-hmm. They always thought it was Forbes. So he, being a probate judge later on, he was a lawyer who became a probate judge briefly, he changed his name to Forbes. Now, Mr. Forbes was a very interesting man. His family came from Bridgewater, Massachusetts.
Or Bridgewater State University, isn't it?
Yes, exactly. And came to Enfield, Massachusetts, which is now at the bottom of the Quabbin.
Right.
But his father was very prominent in Enfield, and so was his brother, both politically and in mercantile. He didn't really want to go to Brown University, but he went to Brown because his uncle, Perez Forbes, was connected with their board of trustees. So he went to Brown University and then came back to the Connecticut Valley and thought of Northampton very much like Mr. Coolidge did when Coolidge went to Amherst College. He thought of Northampton as the place to do his apprenticeship in law. Mm-hmm. And that's what he did. He came here and he never left. And he fell in love with Northampton.
Like we all have.
Yes. Oh, indeed, yes. But he never married. Mr. Forbes never married. And because of it, he amassed quite a fortune for himself in the early banks in Hampshire County and in gold. And he was thinking just close to his death, he died in 1881, thinking of what he could do to benefit the citizens of Northampton. You know, in those days, in the 19th century, it was service and philanthropy. You know, your life counted for something if you did service to humanity and gave back to your community something.
One of the real Victorian values, yes.
Yes, indeed. So Forbes was thinking of his library, and at the same time, it was about 1875, 76 that he was doing this. The fourth meeting house of First Church of Christ Congregational burned to the ground. And he, having a suite of rooms just opposite First Church at the old bank building, saw it burn, and he thought, not my library.
Yeah, a library full of flammable books, right? It's gonna be hard
to So he left a pretty detailed will, and he also left the idea that it should be a fireproof library. Well, the Board of Trustees was charged with that, including the money. Now, it was about $300,000 or thereabouts.
Wow. That's
and in those days, sure. You know, if you translate that to today, it'd be over $1 million.
Oh, well more than that.
Yes.
Sure.
Yeah. So he gave them the money and had a Board of Trustees that was very well-known men in the community, and they were smart, and they kept reinvesting the money, you know, investing it in other things, building it up, until in 1892 or so they came across an architect named William C. Brocklesby.
Okay.
Love that. The little third and fourth graders that I take around the library call him Mr. Broccoli.
It sounds like it.
In any case, Brocklesby had worked with a man named Richard Upjohn. And Richard Upjohn is famous for the original Carnegie Hall in New York City and all those brownstones in Brooklyn. So he studied with Upjohn, and Upjohn knew a family, the Guastavinos, who were from Portugal originally and knew how to do, guess what, fireproof ceramic brick ceilings.
Neat. Yeah.
And now you can't see them in here because we have a dropped ceiling, but if you go down to the mezzanine,
yeah.
You'll see it. Oh. They not only prevent fire, but they also buttress a building pretty well.
Yeah.
So in any case, they hired Brocklesby. He did a beautiful job. They also hired the Berlin Iron Works. Everything that is skeletal in this building is iron. You know, in other words, everything that they put the the stone on is iron.
Was that unique at the time?
It was one of the strongest,
yeah.
You know, other than steel, that was the strongest you could have. And yeah. This is an enormous, enormous building.
It is. It's a palace, yeah.
So they produced, I think, a very beautiful building. But there was controversy because John Clark, who was a merchant in town, had given a very nice, very well-appointed library in the middle of town, which is today known as Memorial Hall. It's right next to the Unitarian Church.
Yes, and that had been built as a library?
It had been built as a library.
I didn't know that. Yeah.
Yes, and on the bottom floor was the library, and on the top floor was the Historical Society. And it was very well thought of, and people were not annoyed, but they wondered why would they need another library? And they called the plans the Castle on the Hill. Why would you put a library that far away from the center of town? Mm-hmm. Good thing they did. Can you imagine parking in front of a library downtown? So in any case, what happened was the John Clark Library eventually closed and merged with Forbes Library.
Well, when Mr. Forbes built this library, it's Smith College is right across the street.
Oh, yes.
Wasn't this the Smith College Library as well?
No, it was the Public Library of Northampton, but all the women at Smith College used it liberally.
Because it was better?
It was, well, by the time this library was built, which is 1893, we opened in 1894, the college was well on its way to becoming a well-known school for sure. Young women. And so they had probably used the John Clark Library first, but with that magnificent collection that Mr. Cutter developed and what he bought in Europe, they used it liberally, to the extent that it probably, in people's minds, made them think that it was Smith College's library, but it was not. It was the Public Library of Northampton.
How much longer before was the original library built, the Clark Library? When was that?
The 1870s or so, 1880s.
And was there a library before that?
There were others. There was the Young Men's Association Library, a very small library. Mm-hmm. All of those early libraries, which go into the 1830s and 40s, were subscription libraries, not mm-hmm. public libraries. Mm. They were private, really. You had to pay into the library mm-hmm. in order to use its materials. And there was another one, a mechanics library for skilled workers.
Yes.
You know, so the concept of the public library, which I like to call the People's University, because it is totally a free library, based, of course, now on taxation, but free to anyone who wants to enter the door and use it, no matter what station you are in life. And that was different than the early 19th century libraries, where you had to be privileged in order to use a library.
Yeah, this is just a fabulous library. Let's talk a little bit more about your collection here.
Sure.
in this room. Mm-hmm. From my experience with libraries, and public libraries in particular, the most popular part of the library is the genealogy room. It
yes.
really gets all the attention.
Mm-hmm.
Do you spend a lot of your time working with people on their genealogies?
Oh, yes. Yes, all the time.
All the time.
Local history and genealogy here is very well used.
Yeah.
I teach genealogy to individuals one-on-one.
Mm-hmm.
I lecture on genealogy outside the library. The same with local history. I work with wonderful local people who are just interested, like you are, in the history of Northampton or the Valley. And I also work with some sterling professors from all over the country who use our collection.
Mm-hmm. Now, I don't know how one person does all of the things that you do. I'm sure you have some help. So you have local history, genealogy. What other aspects are in here?
Oh, well, I've pulled out some
examples,
actually, for you.
Let's take a look at that.
Okay.
Now, Lise, you said you're going to show us some of your treasures. I'm really mm-hmm. looking forward to seeing this as a new Northamptonite.
I'm going to show you autograph books first. In the 19th century, autograph books were very, very popular among children and adults. And you can see the beautiful embossed gold lettering and this lovely design. This one belonged to Arthur G. Hill of Florence, the famous Hill brothers. And what's interesting about this is that the people who signed these were usually friends of the person who had the book, or they were visitors to the Valley, and many of them very famous visitors. The one I love best, and if you'll allow me to, I'll read you a little bit of it, is from Charles Burleigh. Burleigh was a free thinker who lived in Florence and who had a great deal of influence over people here in Northampton. He was Unitarian. by persuasion, free, what we call free Congregationalist. And he was a very well-spoken man and also a man of great stature in the community. And he wrote in Arthur G. Hill's book this. This was in 1860. He misses the real use and meaning of life who either lives an idler or is active only for his own private ends, forgetting the debt he owes to his kind or selfishly neglecting to pay for it. I say the debt, for we actually incur a debt by living in this world and enjoying the bounties of Providence and the fruits of the labors of those who have lived before us. As we cannot pay it directly to those from whom we derive the benefits we owe for, it only remains for us to pay indirectly by making our lives contribute to the common stock of the world's means of well-being, out of which the present and the coming generations are to be supplied. Charles C. Burleigh.
That is definitely the Victorian creed,
isn't it? It is certainly service to humanity and philanthropy. These were, I like to call these, when I work with children and young adults, I like to call this the Facebook of the 19th
Something
century.
They can relate to, yes.
Yes, because that's exactly what it is. It, you know, all your friends write interesting things, you write interesting things to them. Normally there are no photographs in these, but a lot of drawings, beautiful drawings.
I remember, this is just a short little anecdote about Marcel Proust. He visited a man's house one time who had such a volume, and the fellow said to Proust, "Please, Marcel, no big thoughts."
I love it. I don't know if you could say that to Proust.
No, he would fill up a few pages before you stopped him.
We also have a set of very unusual set for any library. We have about 60 of these. These are children's books, chiefly from the 1820s, 30s, 40s. And this one is called Lessons for Laura.
Oh, that is so sweet.
Isn't that
Look
sweet?
At that little drawing. Yeah.
And the little drawings. These were object lesson books. They taught children their ABCs, but they also taught children deportment.
Yeah, along with the reading, you got the lesson. Yeah.
Yes, so that if you open it up, oh, this one talks about the seasons. You know there are 12 months in a year. And you see that little drawing right there? It's very pretty. It's an apple tree with a young person below it. 12 months in a year, in all which months you will find some good things to be had. You will like the summer and the autumn best, because in them are most fruits, also peas and beans in plenty. But you will find many good things to be had, both in spring and winter. This one talks about nature for children. And today, you know, we're trying desperately to teach everyone to be green. The 19th century did it very well. Also, this one is called Duties of Children. This is morality and values and how to treat your parents. And you see how little it is. And these were done, by the way, many of them were done by Mr. Butler, Simeon Butler, who was the chief printer of early Northampton. And if you open it up, you'll see the children standing under the cloud, and the rays of the sun upon them in a very spiritual way.
Was Northampton a center for printing? Or?
Yes, it was, yes. Northampton, what we call the Daily Hampshire Gazette was called the Hampshire Gazette. And in 1786, it was published. They began to publish because of Shay's Rebellion. You know, the pen being mightier than the sword, they thought that they would convince the Shayzites not to rebel. It didn't work, but it produced one of the longest-running papers in New England. I think it's called the third longest-running in New England.
This town has so much history to it.
Isn't it? It's amazing. Yeah. Here are some of the duties of children. Now, you had your ABCs on the left-hand side.
Just hold that for a second. We're going to come right in on it. Okay.
And, of course, children would learn to at this time period, to use what we call English script. It was a very understandable hand. And it says here, there's a little baby, by the way, in a cradle mm-hmm. down here. Love your father and mother. They love you very dearly, and they have taken care of you ever since you were born. They loved you and took care of you even when you were poor, little, helpless babes that could not talk nor walk about, nor do scarcely anything but cry and give a great deal of trouble.
Oh my God, I feel so guilty already.
Who is so kind to you as your parents are? Who takes so much pains to instruct you? Who taught you almost everything you know? And here is a young boy speaking to his father.
I've got to get a copy of this for my kids. Seems his Father's Day is tomorrow.
Yes, it is. This is perfect, isn't it?
Those are great.
And this last one,
really interesting that they're printed. Some of them are printed right here in town.
Yes. Some were printed in Greenfield, some were printed in Northampton, some in Springfield, but most in Northampton.
That's just great.
This is called, this is J.H. Butler, early printer of Northampton. Lazy Ned. This is how not to be.
The kids that visit must love these.
When the kids come from the third and fourth grade, it's so fun to see them mm-hmm. look at these. And we have many children from the schools that come.
It's amazing. Yeah, you would think that this would be kind of off limits, but that's really nice of you to share this.
Well, actually, what we do is we teach them how to properly use manuscripts, how to view them, all of that.
That is such a great...
So this one is, this one goes back, you know, you've heard of Metcalf printing?
Yes.
This is the original Metcalf printing.
Let's take a look at that. I'm going to come right in on it.
Okay. Lazy Ned is always, you know, on his back looking up at the clouds. Idleness was not something that was looked upon.
That is a cute little book.
Here it is. And again, the ABCs are here. Ned Sloper is one of those negligent, idle, loitering, lounging sort of boys who are the greatest of trials to their teacher and the objects of contempt with the diligent and enterprising among the scholars, in other words, his peers. Let me give a description of his manners for a single half day, which will answer as a pretty fair specimen of all the half days in the week. And it goes on to say how he goes into the meadows trying to catch butterflies. He doesn't do his studies. He doesn't bring his books home, you know. And at the end, of course, there's a caveat that says, if you act like Lazy Ned, you will get nowhere in life.
I love the alliteration in that, too.
John, this is one of my favorites. It's a volume of poetry edited by John Chadwick. Now, John Chadwick was a Unitarian minister from Boston, but he was also an editor of books, particularly poetry books. Why? Because he himself was a poet. And he knew everyone in poetry at that particular point in time. This is the 19th century. The greatest bookseller here in Northampton during the 19th and early 20th century was Sidney Bridgman. Sidney Bridgman knew all the greats. Every single poet, every single fiction writer, nonfiction writer, he met them. And they came here to Northampton sometimes to stay with him at his home, which was on Elm Street, which he called Elm Home, after the street, or the castle. This book is very important because it is an autographed, single autographed poetry book with interlineations from some of the greatest poets of the time. Emily Dickinson, Longfellow, Eugene Field.
Did he know these people?
He knew them all. Mm-hmm. He knew them all. And this was a birthday present for his daughter, Annie Cleveland Bridgman. He asked them to write something to his young daughter, whom he loved greatly. And they all complied, most of them complied. Emily Dickinson wrote, and of course these are interlineated. That means that they're tipped into the book by Mr. Bridgman. And this is a wonderful little poem called Hummingbird. Now, when Professor Sewell was doing his two-volume set on Emily Dickinson, he called to ask if we had any poems by her. And I said, we have one, only one. And he asked the title, and he said, oh, I must come see it. And he included it in his two-volume set. But it hadn't been printed, it hadn't been put into a book until he did it, as far as I know. And you're seeing Emily Dickinson's handwriting.
That is just great. I've never seen it before.
And I'm going to read just a little bit of it. A root of evanescence with an delusive wheel, a resonance of emerald, a rush of cockatiel, and every blossom on the bush, its tumbled head, the male from Tunis probably, an easy morning's ride, dissolving, dissembling, wheel generating, hummingbird. Isn't that beautiful?
Oh my God, and you read it so well too.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lise. I really love seeing these local imprints at my shop, Gabriel Books. I have such a hard time keeping them in stock. As soon as they come in, they fly out the door. Now, you said that you used to do some digging around town.
Oh, yes, all the time. One of my favorite haunts was on Masonic Street, the old bookshop. And the people I knew there were Mr. and Mrs. Waltz, Mr. Waltz in particular. And he had this two shelves of what I call gold for the local historian and genealogist. He just had wonderful books on the Connecticut Valley and on Northampton. Of course, they were expensive.
Yes.
But every once in a while, if he knew you had a passion for something, he'd give you a break. And I'd wait for that.
You were lucky to be collecting in those days because you can't even find those things.
No, it's very difficult now.
What other little treasures do you have lurking over there at the other end of the table that you want to share with us?
Well, I have quite a number of them.
Yeah, I love that thing on the top. That's
this one is our oldest book.
Oh, yeah.
And you can see, if you touch it, John, you'll see that it's hide. You know, it's actually gut of a calf. And it's what we call a two-in-one book. This is an account book which goes back to the early days of Northampton. The back side, or the first side, belongs to a man named David Wilton, and we think that this goes back to about 1670. Now, Northampton was established in 1654, so this is our oldest book for Northampton. It's not our oldest book for the valley, but for Northampton. You can see where Mr. Wilton began using his pen, his quill pen. You know, he's always getting it started, getting the ink started, and he did it on top of the book, on the actual, what we call the recto and the verso of a book, you know.
And this was an account book, so it was
this is an
account
book. This was for his business, and he was the chief agent for John Pynchon, who was the son of William Pynchon, who had founded Springfield in 1636. William Pynchon made a few mistakes in terms of his theological stances, and so he went back to England for a while. It was pretty hot for him here because the folks both in Connecticut and in Massachusetts were upset with him for publishing a pamphlet on his views. He actually came back to Springfield, but then was forced to go back to Springfield, England, and died there. But his son became the great entrepreneur of the valley. He was the greatest landholder of the Connecticut Valley, what we now call Hampshire County, which went right to the border of Berkshire's and then up through Springfield.
And what was his name again?
John Pynchon.
Oh, okay, right.
And John Pynchon had several agents, people who did work for him in the various settlements. David Wilton was one of the chief agents for what we now consider Northampton. And this is an interesting account book. It tells us so much about the history of early Northampton. It is a gem for that. Economic historians have looked at it. Valley historians, some from UMass and others from the University of Connecticut. And this book actually tells us what was bought and sold early on in this area. And you can see here pounds, shillings, pence, and a beautiful hand, by the way. Beautiful English script telling you who bought or who bartered, because many times in the 1600s, wampum was used. Wampum, as a matter of fact, was of greater value a lot of the time than money coming from England because of the fluctuation, the valuation of the money coming to the colonies. So they used wampum a great deal.
What was wampum exactly?
It was shells. Shells from usually the Wampanoag tribe, those Native Americans who were on Cape Cod, and they would hone them. They would use tools that honed them to a beautiful gleaming shine. And the ones that were more valuable had purple innards to them.
So they did have an innate value.
Oh, yes.
Almost as jewelry.
Mm-hmm. And then they would put a hole in it, and then they'd string them. And if you had 6 feet of wampum like that, you had a lot of money. Yeah.
That's really interesting. Do you have any thing from the Native Americans here in your collection? Any wampum?
No, I certainly don't.
I'll have to look for some for you so you can have it.
Oh, well, it's very, most are in museums.
Yeah.
Many are being reclaimed, thankfully, the Native Americans.
That's a good point.
Because it is their treasure,
that's
neat.
Very interesting.
So in any case, this is a wonderful example of early Northampton's both bartering and buying. You see everything in here from red shirts to socks to, you know, everything that you could possibly imagine that someone would need hoes and rakes and early plows, all of that. Normally, John, we use gloves when we examine these, but as you can see, I'm doing it very, very carefully from the corners.
Now, isn't there some controversy about bare hands versus gloves? Gloves can damage
yes,
the paper.
Yes, the acidity of your hands, and of course, any if you haven't washed your hands before examining something, it can compromise the paper. But many archives today are going over to a gloveless way of looking at manuscripts. The Beinecke Library at Yale, I believe, and the Houghton Library at Harvard no longer uses it. I don't think Cornell uses it.
Make sure the patrons have washed their hands and that their hands aren't
acidic. And yes, exactly. So some believe that even the fibers in the gloves have a more detrimental effect, you know. But in any case, we still use the glove method. But today, for the sake of time, because it takes a while to get used to that, you know.
Do you do anything here with treating the air or trying to keep...
Yes, this is kept at a proper temperature for an archive. And that's a much lower temperature than you would see outside in the arts and music department, for example.
How about air purity?
And air purity and humidity. Yeah.
What is the humidity? What humidity do you try to keep it at?
Well, it varies. It varies
as the weather does.
Yeah.
Yes.
So I'm not going to actually say.
Yeah.
But degree wise, you want it to be 65 degrees or even less.
The summers
than that.
Are in New England are brutal for books.
Yes.
I've had so many people bring me books that they've stored in their basement.
Awful.
And
yes.
It only takes a few weeks.
And those spores go right into the air and they can damage other books.
Yeah.
So when anyone brings me something here and wants me to examine it, I usually examine it outside
really,
the room.
That's a really good call,
Because it could have detrimental effects on this, and we don't want that.
Yeah, not only do you have the curatorial job here, but the preservation is just amazing to keep these papers and leather. And
of course, we have a wonderful archivist. My supervisor is Julie Bartlett Nelson, who is just really a talented archivist, and she is the one really who is responsible for keeping this collection both in order and also in a pristine condition.
It's just amazing how perfectly kept these books are, because I have seen archives where things are just covered in dust. And
yes, I know.
Just piled up. And
it's sad, yes.
Very sad.
It can be very sad.
Okay.
I should mention, John, that this is what we call a two-in-one book. This end of the book is David Wilton's accounts. Paper was at a premium in these days. So if you had an account book and it went down in your family, you know, was given, and if you hadn't finished with all of the pages, you gave it to the next generation and it became, on the other side, Joseph Holly II's account book. He was a lawyer here in Northampton, and from 1712 to 1724, he kept an account, and you can see.
Yes, yeah, that is amazing.
Beautiful handwriting.
Let's get in on that.
And of course, this X right here says that the debt has been paid. Everything is paid off.
I need a couple of those.
I do too. This is another collection, and this is only a portion of the collection, called the Stephen C. Strong Collection. Stephen C. Strong was a direct descendant of Caleb Strong, who lived here in Northampton and was a lawyer, but also he was a great politician who could play both sides of the aisle, and thus he was 11 times governor of the state of Massachusetts.
Wow.
Now, 11 because you were elected every 2 years, you see. Strong was very well thought of. He's one of my favorites. I'm just going to give you a little tiny story about him. He had this great moral fiber. The man was truly a man who you could value his opinion and also his manner of living. When he was a young lawyer, he went to Springfield to get a saddle. And the saddle was quite embellished. It had tassels and beautiful leather carvings on the saddle. In any case, he stopped on what we now call Route 5. Just before he got into the environs of Northampton, he stopped to take his penknife out and take all of the beautiful leather embellishments off. Why? Because it may have offended someone who was less fortunate than himself in terms of, remuneration. So that gives you an idea. And he was very well thought of by all of the fathers of the Revolution, and became not only a representative to the General Court of Massachusetts, but also he became a person who was asked to work on the Constitution of the United States. He never signed his name on the Constitution, not because he didn't want to, but because his wife, he was given a note that his wife and his children were ill. And he came immediately back to Northampton to help with the children and to get them well. That's a man, you know? He thought more of his family than he did of his political life.
That's a very interesting story. Yes. Thank you, Elise.
You're welcome. And anyway, this particular collection from the Stephen C. Strong collection, and there are many others. Sure.
Upright. So, yeah, there we go. Okay.
This is Daniel Shea's petition to the Massachusetts General Court for his pension from the Revolutionary War, from the War of the Revolution. He fought in the War of the Revolution and wanted either to be given adequate pay, adequate payback for it, or a pension that would last till the end of his life. And of course, this was controversial because he had rebelled, but as far as we know, he got the pension. Humbly, Daniel Shays of Pelham in the county of Hampshire in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, that on the 19th day of April, in the year of our Lord, 1775, your petitioner entered into service of the United States and held the commission of a lieutenant in the army, which encamped near Boston in the same year. So he tells his entire story
that
of his Revolutionary War
document.
Record.
That is amazing. How did you come to have this?
The Strong family is a family in Northampton who is very historically minded. And Stephen C. Strong decided to give this to the Forbes. And it is a magnificent collection of papers, chiefly letters and papers that have to do with the Shays, but also letters and papers that have to do with Caleb Strong's long service to the state of Massachusetts and the United States.
And to take it one step further back, how did they get the Shays' documents? Did they know Shea?
It came down to them in the family, because these were all letters that Caleb Strong had saved during his lifetime. Stephen C. Strong, being a direct descendant, decided it would be best in a library.
That's just a fabulous collection to have.
It
That's
is.
That's a real unique treasure
Very
that
unique.
Really reflects the history. Of
and many people working on the Shaysites come here to look at. William Pynchon of Springfield. Now you can see
that. How old is this? I mean,
oh, this is the 1630s.
Oh mm-hmm. my goodness.
Mm-hmm. And we got it because Judd acquired it. Now, I have to explain about Sylvester Judd. Sylvester Judd was editor of the Hampshire Gazette in the 1820s, and his passion was local history. I really love this man.
What were his years again? What were his years?
He was born in 1789. He died in 1860, just short of the Civil War. And during his lifetime, he had always wanted to be educated and to be a gentleman. His father didn't have the money to send him to college. As a matter of fact, his father wanted him to work in his general store in West Hampton. But, you know, Mr. Judd was a dreamer. You know, he just was not mercantile in his heart. So journalism became his way of being a gentleman and educated. He was a very good writer. And he collected materials. Now, this is one of the original materials that he collected. But there are 56 handwritten volumes of what we call the Judd Manuscript. And I'm going to show you a little of this.
You have all 57, I assume.
We have all 56, yes, we do, yes.
Where's number 57?
57 is this one, which is an original.
I see, okay.
I'm going to show you what he copied. He copied everything. And he also interviewed people about their families. It's a treasure trove for genealogists.
Sort of an oral historian of the time.
Oh, yeah, he was fabulous.
Now, what is he copying here? What is
This particular one is the church book of the First Church of Christ Congregational, showing the admissions after the Great Awakening, after the revival of 1735 by Jonathan Edwards. So this is in Mr. Judd's hand, but he used the originals and copied them. Basically, Judd was a copyist. He copied original records. Now, a lot of times he didn't tell you where he was getting these things. Sometimes he'd interlineate it in the margins of whatever he was working on, but chiefly he would just simply copy the material, and he'd go from place to place to place.
Has he saved a number of things that have been lost?
Yes, there are certain things that were lost in floods, for example.
Yeah.
By the way, he didn't just do Western Massachusetts, he did Northern Connecticut as well. We have Connecticut volumes. It's
obsessed.
So wonderful what you can find here.
And all in one place is what's
yes.
amazing. You don't have to go to all these churches and dig and find all
right,
these records.
Right. Well, we're blessed also with some of the original records of First Church of Christ Congregational. But for someone who is working on Jonathan Edwards and wants to know who was admitted
mm-hmm.
as a member of the church
so important
at
in
this
days.
Time.
Yes. And where you sat.
Yes, and where you sat. And that's the other thing. He also collected seating plans and all of
where
that.
Where you sat
sort
in the church
thing.
Was very important. This is a great transition to see what you have in your Jonathan Edwards collection. Okay.
This happens to be a page from the personal account book of Mr. Edwards. And again, you can see the X's where things were paid off. Either he paid someone or someone paid him for services. But this happens to be the personal account book, the account book that would be used as his discretionary fund. And what I mean by that is if he needed to give monies to a member of his congregation because of some great need, Or it also lists household items, like thread for Mrs. Edwards when she would sew dresses or coats, or his tippet, which was that beautiful collar that she made for him, two-point collar. It's called a tippet. You can see just about here, I'm reading backwards, but just about here it says, Mr. Hopkins for a cake of chocolate. Now, chocolate didn't come to you in little cakes like this. It came in big cakes. And if Mr. Hopkins, who was his friend, Samuel Hopkins, was going to Hartford or Boston, he was asked to stop at the chocolate shop. And there was a reason. Not only did Mr. Edwards have a sweet tooth, but he also had melancholia. He had some problems with depressive moods, moods that went down. So he knew a little bit about how that made him feel better. Chocolate makes your endorphins move.
That is really interesting.
You know, it's like ice cream, you know? Mm-hmm. So they'd buy quite a bit of chocolate. There's also some wonderful household things here. 26 feet of what we call Holland, which was this gauzy, beautiful material that women would make dresses out of in this period. And they called it Holland because it indeed came from Holland. It came from the Netherlands. And it was quite a thing to receive that imported cloth to make things with. And Mrs. Edwards would do that. She was an expert needle worker, and she was also a great seamstress. This is an original letter. It's a manuscript item that has three parts to it. This is a letter written to Eliezer Wheelock, who was a kinsman of Mr. Edwards. What I mean by that is he had married into the Edwards family. He was indeed the Reverend Mr. Wheelock of Lebanon, Connecticut at this point in time. He becomes, by the way, the first president of Dartmouth College later on in his life. So he's a pretty important fellow. And after a particularly successful revival in 1741, Mr. Edwards sends him this letter. And in the letter, it's three parts, really. The first part has to do with Mr. Wheelock's revival and how successful it was and how many people had found salvation. The second part is really interesting because revivals after the beginning of the Great Awakening here in Northampton, it was as if Mr. Edwards lit a fire through the entire Connecticut Valley and up into Connecticut. And everyone wanted a revival. Now, his father had been at East Windsor his entire pastorate, but he did not have a revival, and his people were chafing under that, and Edwards knew it. So when he wrote another letter to Wheelock and said, will you please gather a group of young ministers to preach a revival in East Windsor with my father. And they did, and it was extremely successful. So this is a thank you also. So this is congratulations on your recent revival. This is thank you for bringing revival to my father's congregation. But this one, this last part is the most important part. He speaks about Whitfield, George Whitfield, who was the pioneer missionary from England, who came to the colonies and set the colonies on fire with his preaching. 1741 was the beginning of troubles for Mr. Edwards, theological troubles with his congregation. And he says here, would that my congregation would listen to me the way they have listened to Mr. Whitfield recently.
Rival.
Yes. So he was
a rival in the revival.
Yes, yeah. But he loved Whitfield and considered him a great friend. But my favorite line from this is when he says to, at the end of the letter, he says to Mr. Wheelock, "May you be a burning and shining light for the Lord." That's taken right out of the epistles of St. Paul. And it really shows Edwards's focus, which was the salvation of souls. May you be a burning and shining light.
He was very controversial here in Northampton and was forced to leave. Did he go on to find success elsewhere as a revival?
Yes. He went on to Stockbridge, Massachusetts, where he wrote his greatest, probably on freedom of the will and on original sin, was written there. I look upon Northampton as a crucible, if you will, almost as if Mr. Edwards was in a blacksmith fire here in Northampton, where he was refined here.
He was tested.
Tested and refined. Mm-hmm. And because of Northampton, he went on to write some of his greatest theological works. Then, of course, everything was familial for him. You know, he came here to help his grandfather, Solomon Stoddard, who was the great and grand master of this entire valley for 60 years of pastorate. It was all familial, you know. Everything that happened to him was familial. His family wanted him to come to rescue his grandfather because his grandfather was getting older. He needed help in his in his ministry. In the beginning, Edwards was the fair-haired boy of the congregation, truly. But later on, after the death of his grandfather, he and the first revival that he had in 1735, he changed his theological stance from what we call full covenant to halfway covenant. I'm not going to go into that because it's a little complicated. But it was a different theological stance. It was very much like Boston's stance. Think Cotton Mather and Increase Mather. So having had Solomon Stoddard as their pastor for all those years, and then to shift to a full covenant theology was very difficult for the congregation. They chafed under it. And because of that, he couldn't quite convince them over the years that full covenant was the way to go. And then some certain things happened that created stirs in the community, and we don't have enough time to go into that.
No, you told me that many congregations still have a pilgrimage here to visit.
Yes.
Because of Jonathan Edwards.
I see so many people coming to talk to me about Edwards in Northampton. Last summer, just as an illustration, I had a pastor and 40 of his congregants come from Florida. He pastors a church of 3,000 people. They're very much enamored of Edwards. They're a Reform church, Reform congregational church. And I had to show them all the sites, and of course there aren't many sites left in Northampton of Edwards, but I showed him where David Brainerd and Jerusha Edwards are buried. Of course, Edwards is not buried here. We have to, you know, tell people that right away. He's buried at Princeton in the old burial ground there because of familial things. His son-in-law, Aaron Burr Sr., the Reverend Aaron Burr Sr., dies prematurely of smallpox. He's called by the board of Princeton, what would be Princeton University later on, and will you come? You know, the only one who could fill Solomon Stoddard's shoes in Northampton was Edwards, and the only one who could fill Aaron Burr's Senior's of shoes in Princeton was Edwards. So he's pulled by family responsibility all the time. Yeah. And of course, he goes to Princeton. There's another outbreak of smallpox. He's, you know, Edwards is the greatest mind of his century. He was a philosopher, he was a scientist, and he was a theologian. Because he was a scientist, because he believed in science, he had an inoculation against the smallpox done, but it went awry. And so he became ill with smallpox and died, sadly. On his deathbed, besides saying some very beautiful things about the Lord, he said this: "Tell Sarah, we have had an uncommon union." Because not only was the romance there between Mr. and Mrs. Edwards, but she was hand in glove. Think of a hand that goes inside a glove. She fit everything that was necessary for his pastorate to go forward.
That's just an incredible story, Lisa, and you tell it so well. Thank you so much for sharing your treasures in this treasure hold here at
you're
Forbes
welcome.
Library. And I have to say, the greatest treasure here is you, because you know so much and can relate it and tell it and carry on this history to make it alive.
Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot. Thank you.